So this is Clive Davis, who's one of the most successful record executives in history. We think Clive's loving the song, and Alan and I are sitting there, we're in like Flynn, this is amazing, we're already buying our yachts and stuff in our heads, right?
I'm Alan Rich, and I'm a lyric writer with a good melody sense.
I'm Judd Friedman, and I am a songwriter and a record producer and also a screenwriter.
I always say there's a BJ and an AJ, before Judd and after Judd. And both Judd and I had careers. We were getting cuts. We were collaborating with people. The first hit song I wrote with Steve Werfel and Pam Reswick was the Natalie Cole hit ballad, I Live For Your Love, produced by Dennis Lambert. And it was right after that that Judd and I kind of met each other. And I really do feel like my whole life changed because, you know, when you find your musical soulmate or your soulmate in life, you know it. And I think that Judd and I knew it. We didn't collaborate too much with other people for the next 30 years, unless it was with an artist.
But back in the early days, it was very often that Alan would hand me either a chunk of a lyric or notes on a lyric. But he was more, I'm going to give you a lyric and I'll write the music to it, and then we'll some of the music, and then we'll write the rest of the song together.
Judd and I would sit in a room, we'd throw ideas at each other. And we'd start writing together.
Yes, there's a lot of more organically.
There's a lot of magic in that, and we've written some really great songs that way too. Yeah. Or then we, you know, you have to write entirely different when you're writing for a film.
The songwriting world hears that Whitney Houston is doing a film, and they need four songs for the film. Now, everyone is in a frenzy, of course, because she's the biggest and one of the most respected, certainly one of the most popular artists in the world. Everyone loves her. And she's making a movie, and we know it's going to be huge. So every songwriter and publisher worth any kind of salt gets a little breakdown of the four scenes. These are the four places we need songs for. No script, no video, nothing. Like a little paragraph. We need a song about this for this scene. This is what's going to happen. One. Number two, we need a song, right? Four of these. So we, like everybody else, we get it. And we run down to the studio and we pound out a song that we're really excited about. And Alan will tell you the origin of that. It was just coincidentally.
We were writing the song specifically for The Bodyguard and for Whitney Houston. But it just so happened to coincide with a 10-year breakup in my own life. I was driving in my car. He was sitting next to me. And we had broken up and gotten back together many times. But this time I knew was the last time I was going to be in a relationship with this person. And he lived in a building on Sycamore in Hollywood, and the building had a glass staircase that he walked up. And as he got out of the car and I said goodbye to him, he said goodbye to me. I watched him walk up the steps, and my knee-jerk reaction was to go chase after him. But I didn't do that. I pulled out a piece of paper that I had. I always kept paper in my car. I put it on the steering wheel, and I wrote, I want to run to you. I want to run to you. And I wrote, just like I always did before, come knocking at your door. I want to run to you how I want to come to you, but you're not there to run to anymore. That was the original lyric at that moment for the breakup of a 10-year relationship. But it was specifically written for Whitney Houston, and it just so happened that that was coinciding with us writing the song.
Because the scene we wrote the song for originally was a breakup song. Because that's where it was supposed to be used in the film. So we wrote this song, and then we had to figure out how are we going to get them to hear it, because we knew every songwriter and publisher was submitting stuff. It was going to be thousands and thousands of songs submitted. So,
and we somehow had to get it to Clive Davis.
We wanted to get it as close to Clive as possible.
And we didn't know Clive Davis. Our publishers knew Jerry Griffith, who was Clive's right-hand man, and we all decided that if we sent the song to Jerry and he liked it, he would put it on Clive's desk. And that's exactly what happened. And you can take it from there.
Yeah. So we submit the song, and then we go on about our lives. And Alan comes home one day and has a voicemail.
Going to Clive Davis. I like this song. I'm sure Jerry has told you. I did play it for Whitney. Whitney likes it a lot, too.
We call him, and he says, we love the song. We're really excited about it. It's perfect for that scene. And Alan and I are going, we're in. This is it. We're there. We're in Whitney's movie. This is amazing.
And then he says, not so fast.
Exactly. He says, there's just this one little thing. He says, you know, could you make the demo sound a little bit more like a Whitney Houston record? So now remember, this is Clive Davis, whom we love, who's probably the most sophisticated and certainly one of the most successful record executives in history, explaining to us what he wants. I'm thinking he's going to give me a really elaborate description of what a Whitney Houston record entails. So I said, well, what do you mean by that, Clive? He says, you know, like a Whitney Houston record. So Alan and I are going, what does that mean? Clive, what, you know, like we go back and forth about 8 times and finally we hang up and he that's all he says. Make it sound like a Whitney record. So all Alan and I could think about was he wants it to be a little more fully produced. So we did. We produced it a little bit more fully. We put some bass in, we put some drums in, we bulked it up a little bit. But the trickiest part of it was...
Well, the drums were out of time.
The song was out of time.
And so the drums had to match. Some parts were slow sometimes.
Yeah, I want to run to...
It took 4 hours to do just the drum track.
3-minute song, yeah.
Right.
So we give it to Clive, and he goes, love it, fantastic, it's in.
So after Clive says, I love it, we're thinking, oh my God, this is happening. Until the director calls us. He says to us, we love your song, but it wouldn't be a big deal to rewrite the whole lyric, right?
We almost have a heart attack. But of course, what is our response for all you fledgling songwriters and artists out there?
I know
there?
What it is. No problem.
So we hang up the phone, we collapse. You know, our lives are flashing before our eyes. And then Clive calls. And Clive says, listen, I heard what happened with Mick. Because they had decided to change the placement of the song to a scene where it was a falling in love song.
Take a chance on me song.
Which is where it ended up in the film, from a we're breaking up song. So Clive calls and says, listen, I want you guys not to worry about this. We really love the song. Try it, see if you can make it work. But if it doesn't work, Whitney's going to have a greatest hits record coming out in a year. And we'll use it for the greatest hits as the extra, as the new song for the greatest hits record. So Alan and I hang up and we say,
not going to happen.
No friggin' way.
We got to land this.
We got to get in this record. So we rewrite the song.
The original breakup chorus was, I want to run to you. I want to run to you. Just like I always did before. Come knocking at your door. I want to run to you. How I want to come to you. But you're not there to run to anymore.
Then the lyric morphed into a take a chance on me song or a possible falling in love song. So I went in the studio with Dave and built the track. And then Whitney comes to town to do the vocal. She was dressed down. She didn't have any makeup on. Right. She was wearing jeans. She looked so cute and sweet. And she was so nice.
Judd and I going to the recording studio. Whitney Houston could barely speak. She was hoarse as could be.
And she sits right down and she pulls out a lyric sheet and she says, Judd, show me how to sing the song. And she was so nice and unaffected.
Correct. She really
sits
was.
Down and she spends a half an hour with me going line by line through the lyric, even though she knew the song like the back of her hand. She was a total pro, but she wanted the songwriters to kind of walk her through the phrasing and the little details and the emotions of each moment. And then she starts recording the vocal.
She couldn't speak. She sings, you take a double take, because it was so extraordinary. And 90% of the actual vocal was that day that she was in the recording studio, even though she was hoarse.
She kept saying to me from the vocal booth, she kept saying, Judd, did I do that right? And then like the sea of heads and faces, all these luminaries in the studio would turn like this to me, like, what are you gonna say to this woman? Because everything she sang was so amazing. Every mistake, she was so great. I mean, Alan and I have been very blessed in our lives and our careers to work with some amazing recording artists and amazing singers. And there are, you know, some that are not that great and some pretty good and some very good and some great. And then there's Whitney Houston, who is just in a whole other ballpark. I mean, she was in her own league. There was nobody else in that league. So what do you say to her? Well, you know, it was great, but maybe you could, you know, the real melody goes, and she was so cool about it. It was never like fighting with her to get a performance. She wanted it to be great. She was just a dream to work with.
When she hits notes or she does runs, it comes from her soul and she hits places that no one else could really hit. And you can even see how many years later you hear so many people singing Run to You. Nobody can match Whitney's version of it.
She was incredibly gifted. The sound of her voice was incredibly beautiful. That cannot be taught. But as a singer, your soul comes through, your heart comes through, your persona comes through. Just artists in general, you show yourself, and herself was so beautiful and so soulful and so powerful. I mean, I don't think there's ever been anybody like her. And certainly in this generation, she's the voice. I wanna run to you.